thank you all for coming this morning to talk about guns, gun policy in North Carolina. These are huge issues facing not only Buncombe County, not only Western North Carolina, North Carolina, and the country. So we are a news organization, an online news organization, providing in-depth and investigative reporting. And we feel part of that is also providing an opportunity for you all to hear directly from our sources and directly from us as journalists, so that you can ask questions and be a part of the conversation. I think that's very important, and be a part of an independent conversation. We do not represent Democrats or Republicans. We are really a forum for people to have information and dialogue with one another. So we're very excited for all of you to be here today, and I hope you all please partake in the refreshments, and I hope you all also had a chance to meet and talk with our sheriff and Buncombe County reps from the State House. So if you haven't, please let me introduce you, all of these fine-looking folks. This is Sheriff Van Duncan from Buncombe County. This is Representative Susan Fisher, who's a Democrat representing a portion of Buncombe County. Representative Brian Turner, who also represents Buncombe County, is also a Democrat. And Representative John Ager, who represents a portion of Buncombe County and is also a Democrat. And for those of you who might not know, we recently hired a managing editor at Carolina Public Press. We're very excited. And he is Frank Taylor, and he will be our moderator today. So to let you know a little bit about what will happen, for 30 minutes, we'll have a conversation up here. Frank will ask some questions, and these folks will have an opportunity to talk with one another and to answer them. And then we'll open it up for 30 minutes of questions and answers to all of you. And I say this at every one of our newsmakers, it really is a time for a Q&A and not a debate or to make a political statement, but really to be a part of asking questions of these folks. So with that said, I'll turn it over to Frank, and thank you again for being here.
Thanks.
Well, thanks to everybody for coming out on this morning when it's not snowing, which we were worried a little bit about a few days ago, but the forecast improved and we just had some fog to scare us a little bit this morning. Something I want to address off the top is the elephant in the room, which is the lack of elephants in the room. The panel consists of Democratic elected officials. Now, we also invited some Republican elected officials. For whatever reason, those individuals didn't participate in this particular session. Some of them cited conflicts. It happens that we have the House delegation from Buncombe County well represented, and it could be partially the venue. We had a session on another hot issue, water issues in Western North Carolina in October, and we had a representative who was from Henderson County, where that was conducted, who participated in that, who's a Republican. So it just happens this particular time that we have a Democratic panel. That's not to say there aren't nuances and differences of opinion on these issues. And we'll explore some of those as we talk about gun issues in North Carolina and issues more broadly nationally that certainly will affect North Carolina as well as the rest of the country. One of the interesting pieces of legislation on guns that came out of the General Assembly recently was House Bill 562, which was approved with some bipartisan support. Representative Turner was one, I believe, of only four Democrats who supported that legislation and had an amendment that was included in it that broadened, it allowed for a study to look at a different type of background check.
Right. It was a study to look at ways to give some public access to a NICS-style background check so that if people engaged in private sales wanted to conduct those kind of checks, they would have access to that. So it's a study to be completed, I think, in 2017.
I'm interested, just to start off, those of you who are in the legislature, can you talk to us a little bit about what your take on that piece of legislation was, and why you ultimately chose to support it or not? I know there was some rival legislation that I believe Representative Fisher was involved with. Can you talk to us about that process from the last session?
Well, I can say for, at least for many of us on the Democratic side of the aisle, one of our main concerns was that it looked like local law enforcement was going to be sort of removed from the picture when it came to gun control and gun safety, and they were going to be either asked to do a whole lot more than they were doing already or be taken out of the picture altogether. I think that the main concern that I had was, when it all boiled down, was there were pieces of this legislation as it was originally written that would have allowed legislators, for example, to have concealed carry in the General Assembly, in the building. And, you know, many of us were just pretty beside ourselves about how that was not an appropriate place for there to be guns. And we know that there are folks in the legislature now who have concealed carry permits, and maybe there are some on occasion that actually carry them into the legislature. We've sort of wondered if that were the case. But we didn't feel like it was something that we wanted to make just a blanket sort of change to. One of the things that I found interesting during that debate was that a lot of the folks from Every Town for Gun Safety were present on the premises during the debate of that piece of legislation. And they are a nonpartisan group that actually talks about not the prohibition of guns, not taking away guns, but about the safety of guns in our society. And so I think by the time the debate was done, it wasn't everything that we all wanted, but it was less bad. And I think that the Every Town folks had a lot to do with maybe swaying some of the legislation and taking out some of the worst parts.
Yeah, and I would just add, you know, the bill wasn't, by the time it was done, there were the moms in the red coats, the red shirts, that were also very effective. They moderated the bill a great deal. I almost voted for it. There was one provision in there that which is a bigger issue with me with the legislature, is that they were trying to prevent local governments from passing, you know, some legislation that might work better in their communities. I don't like the legislature, you know, pushing around local governments like they've been doing. I also had an amendment to, there was a provision in there to not allow people to bring guns to the state fair in Raleigh. I had an amendment to also prevent that at the state fair, at the fairgrounds here, which almost passed, but didn't quite. When I went to the fair, I noticed everywhere was, you know, no guns allowed, so I didn't quite know what was going on, but anyway, that was some of the reasons that I ended up voting against it.
Sheriff, one of the things that was in this legislation was a measure that the proponents of it thought would bring more consistency to the way in which pistol purchase permits are handled by sheriff's offices. I think there was also some concern that it might tie local law enforcement's hands with the way that's handled. Can you address that and how that's worked out now that the legislation's passed?
I can. It's really extremely complex. It's about a 30-minute conversation, and I know we don't have time for that. I'll try. A lot of the issues are around folks who have mental health issues, consumers of mental health services, their access to firearms and being able to buy firearms. And because the national NICS check has very little ability to assess, or very little of that data or information has been shared when a NICS check is done. And if you're not familiar with what a NICS check is, that's what you do to purchase a long gun, a shotgun or a rifle, if you go into Walmart or any other federal firearms license dealer. And the big concern is, in purchasing a handgun, is the sheriff still had the ability to go in and look at mental health records. And we're not talking about somebody who goes to the doctor to receive some medication for depression. We're talking about folks who who involuntary commitments and the likes of that, and on, and being deemed as mentally not able to purchase or own a firearm. So there's a lot of debate about that, and what I would tell you is I would be for the consistency of putting it all under a NICS check once NICS comes online and proper information is shared, and it is a thorough background check. Once we know that that's going on, I don't think you're going to get a lot of resistance from local sheriffs about holding on to that permitting process. Because when we issue a permit, they're good for 5 years. And there's an issue around somebody being eligible, but then after that time period when the permit's issued, you know, who's responsible for going and checking? And a lot of your federal firearms dealers will not go back and run a NICS check if they're presented a pistol purchase permit from a local sheriff. So that causes some problems. And like I say, it's extremely complex, but I think the feeling of most of the sheriffs, and we had a Western Sheriff's meeting yesterday, is that once we feel like NICS is online and doing a pretty thorough background check and information being shared, I think most sheriffs are ready to give up that permitting process. And by the way, we, you know, it's a $5 permit that probably costs us $20 to issue, so it's really not a money-making issue for the sheriffs. It costs us more money than it brings in.
One of the hot issues as we began to look at the topic for this month's forum has been mass shootings across the country. And as we were having that discussion, the San Bernardino shooting took place and certainly was shocking. Regardless of what one thinks about these regulation issues, it certainly was a strong message to the nation. I don't want to say it was a wake-up call because it was hardly the first of such shootings, but it was perhaps one of the most shocking we've seen. In response to that, the White House announced some initiatives. I'm interested from hearing from each of you about those, on really three different questions that raises, one of which is the value of the specific measures that the White House has proposed. Second of all, whether it's ideal that that's being done at the federal level versus state or local level. And third, the practicality and the legality of it being done by executive order as opposed to having the backing of Congress. And I'd particularly like to hear from the legislators about your thoughts on this.
Yeah, I'll start out here. I felt like that the actual rules that were passed down after all the hullabaloo were really fairly mild. And when I talked to Van about it, he said they were sensible and okay. To the constitutional question, I can't answer. I think one of the things you notice with every one of these things is how the NRA is able to create a big stir about it and basically use it to sell a lot more guns, and that bothers me. I think the actual rules were minimal, and I wish that we could get to a place in this conversation. I mean, I'll just say that there are not many countries in the world where we would get a crowd to talk about this issue like we have here this morning, and get to a place where we can be sensible about what can we do to help stop the mass shootings. The bigger issue is even suicide. We're probably, everyone in this room has been touched by suicides with using guns. Are there some scientific ways we can try to minimize these horrible tragedies? You know, it was Mr. Deer, my neighbor in Fairview, who went out to Planned Parenthood. He was kind of motivated by the big political discussion going on about Planned Parenthood and I guess guns as well. And he doesn't seem to be a particularly stable gentleman, but he had access to guns, and another horrible tragedy. So I'm all for sensible tragedy prevention, and I think I'll pretty much do whatever Van tells me to do.
Good answer.
Well, I'm not going to disagree with John that listening to Van is a good idea. I think, and I've said it to him before, and I think we're very fortunate of the sheriff we have in Buncombe County. The same can't be said necessarily across all counties in the state, and I think that leads sometimes to the problems we see and some of the legislation that we see. because there is sort of unequal application of some of the laws that are currently on the books and some of the policies. We're very fortunate to have Sheriff Van Duncan. With President Obama's executive orders or actions, I think that there are a number of good steps that he's put in there in terms of increasing ATF officers, allowing for better background check processes by sort of bolstering those areas. The mental health piece is really important. But you know, I think that there was an outsized response to some of those things. It's very interesting. I happened to be on a number of mailing lists, and it was very interesting. I received two emails the day following his actions. One from the National Shooting Sports Foundation. I'm a hunter. I engage in shooting sports. So I like to follow this stuff. National Shooting Sports Foundation came out basically saying, you know, we share the goal of reducing intentional misuse of guns. We're interested to learn more about President Obama's plans and how we can, you know, help support some of these issues. And then the NRA came out with a statement basically blasting President Obama and essentially, you know, calling him the deceiver-in-chief and things like that. And I think that this kind of vitriol really undermines the ability for folks like us to be able to get into a room and have these legitimate conversations. When I look at one firearms and sporting organization that says, how do we work with what's going on here and how do we make our world safer? And then you've got one organization that's basically stoking the fears that guns are going to be grabbed. That does us a disservice as a community. I think that, you know, the direction that President Obama is going to be, you know, is going to help. But as to the constitutionality of it, I'm not a lawyer. I guess that's for the courts to decide.
I would echo much of what's been said, but I also want us to think about this whole issue in terms of public health and public safety. I believe that if we could just get away from the whole business of buying and selling guns and think more about who is buying and who is selling and what they're being used for. There was a great editorial by Nick Kristof in the New York Times, I think it's the 6th of January, and I would absolutely direct any of your listeners to it. But it had to do with just numbers. It also talked about how the liberal left sort of gets the NRA going with the whole idea of this knee-jerk sort of reaction to let's get rid of the guns, get rid of the guns. Well, I don't think that we should come at it from that standpoint as much as we should come at it from the public health standpoint, because his editorial said that there were roughly as many people dying of guns in America on President Obama's watch as have been killed in the Syrian civil war. Now, the estimates are from fewer than 200,000 to more than 300,000. And that, of course, includes suicides. But again, there's another public health issue right there. And it is really worth mentioning that as many Americans have died from gun deaths as have died in the Syrian civil war. So I think we need to put it into terms that people can really kind of get a hold of when it comes to just simply the public health and safety of our citizens. One of the items that President Obama asked for in his executive order was a PIN, an ID that you would have to engage in order to use a gun. Similar to what you would use at the banks with your debit card, a PIN number. And, you know, I'm all about looking at what is new in science and technology. Let's take advantage of that and see what we can do to make it safer to have a gun. So,
Sheriff, some words have already been put in your mouth, but would you agree in general with what's been said on that?
Yes and no. I love Susan and respect her. There's a lot of issues around science and technology and control of access to firearms through those type of through those type of messages, or those type of methods. I mean, what I would say is some of the executive orders, I understand folks' issues with executive orders being used. All the presidents have used them for different things. I understand the issues around it. What I would say with the things that came out from President Obama, they were pretty common sense and not, by most people's opinions, who are Second Amendment supporters, and I'm a shooter like Brian. That's part of what I do. I don't golf. I'm a shooting sport person and do those things. What I would say is when you look at those things and what they're intended to do, they're pretty common sense, and I think they will make things safer. And I'll give you an example. When I was talking about NICS checks, one of the executive orders, it frees up the sharing between states with the NICS system around mental health issues. And there's always been a lot of standing behind the HIPAA laws to prevent states from doing that. So if we're ever going to get a robust NICS check, this had to happen. There's also a lot of folks who buy and sell guns as if they were a federally licensed firearms dealer that do not have the license. And basically, one of the executive orders is saying, if you're doing this to benefit, even though they didn't put a number on it, which I was kind of glad to see that, but what they're saying is we're going to increase ATF's ability to go out and investigate. And if you're online selling guns, and right now in the state of North Carolina, individual sales, if you're talking about long guns, rifles and shotguns, then there's no background check or anything that needs to be done between individuals. So if you've got individuals who are selling and buying a large amount of firearms and turn them around, this is probably a good measure. Most of your licensed federal firearms dealers support this. So there are some things that have come through with executive action that you look at and you say, well, that makes sense. We don't know that we wanted executive action to get them there or executive orders to get them there. But it's like Brian mentioned, there is such a polarizing logjam in Congress. When you start talking about guns, it's almost a no-go from the onset. Mm-hmm. So some of these things needed to take place.
And actually, I want to expand just something the sheriff's talking about, and I think it's good for everyone kind of in general who's listening to this conversation to understand when we're talking about private sales of long guns, shotguns, and rifles.
Yes.
So if I'm going to sell Roni my shotgun because I can't hit anything with it, which is not the case, I can sell that to Roni, and there's no background check involved. Now, if I've got a handgun and I want to sell that to Roni in a private sale, he's got to show me his carry permit or his gun permit, his pistol permit that he's received from the sheriff's office so that I know with that handgun transaction, a background check has been done. So for all sales, public and private, of handguns, a permit and a background check is used. For private sales of long guns, there is no background check. For sales of long guns between a firearms dealer, a licensed firearms dealer, and a person, there is a background check. So when people talk about no background checks, really what that is talking about is the private sale of long guns between two individuals. So that's just for a point of clarification.
I want to zoom in on something that Susan mentioned about looking at this as a public health issue, and I want to particularly look more narrowly at one aspect of it, which is domestic violence homicides in North Carolina. Last year, according to the domestic violence, the North Carolina Coalition Against Domestic Violence, we have 54 DV-related murders, 31 of which were committed with a firearm in North Carolina. We do have some legislation in place that relates directly to this. In North Carolina, somebody who is convicted of a felony or misdemeanor crime of domestic violence toward a spouse, former spouse, or cohabiting intimate partner or person with whom the offender shares a biological child is prohibited from owning firearms. Likewise, a person under a permanent restraining order is not permitted to own firearms. But some gaps have been identified in the law as it stands. People who have been convicted for domestic violence against a current or former dating partner are not restricted. People who are convicted of stalking are not restricted. People who are under a temporary ex parte restraining order are not necessarily restricted in all states. I think North Carolina might be an exception on that. Some of these notes are national. People who are legally prohibited from owning guns are sometimes able to get them anyway. because local records don't contain enough detail to flag those offenders when they go to purchase a gun, and offenders can purchase firearms at gun shows from private sellers bypassing the background system. That's one of the reasons why the background system is a concern. Is there an environment in which we might be able to see some movement in the legislature to close some of these loopholes, specifically with regard to people who are identified as dangerous individuals, have already committed a lethal crime, or have already been identified as a threat to other people, are already not supposed to own guns under certain circumstances? Is there a chance that we might be able to see some legislation move on that?
I'm not sure about that, because if you look at the law that was just passed, and right. This is something that has sort of given me a question that I'll bet you can answer, Van. You have this 5-year permit that's good for 5 years. And then, as Van suggested, unless you have all of that mental health information and all of that information about the last time a spouse assaulted his or her spouse, you can't take that gun away. There's something, there are loopholes, and there's that 5-year window. My permit is good, you can't take my gun away, when a lot of things could happen without any sort of safety or precautionary measures in place. So definitely loopholes. I would be interested to hear from Sheriff Duncan about how that is addressed, because if you have this permit that's good for 5 years, how do you get into the system when you know that you've had an incident occur? Like a domestic.
You want me to answer?
Yeah, and I want to throw an additional question if you want to touch on this as well. I know this from journalistic coverage of what's happened in some other counties, and it does not reference anything that's happened in Buncombe. But I know of cases where the deputy assigned to go pick up the guns from the offender happens to be his drinking buddy, and those guns don't get picked up, even though they were supposed to be. So I'm also curious about ways in which we can put more teeth into these laws to ensure that they really are carried out consistently.
Let me deal with Susan's first as far as the 5-year thing. And sometimes there's a little bit of misnomer around the pistol purchase permit. It's really not a permit to own a gun. It's a permit to go purchase a gun. So when we issue those and they're good for 5 years, it deals with their ability to take this permit and purchase a weapon from a federal firearms license dealer. So when somebody commits a crime that would be a disqualifier for them to be able to have that pistol purchase permit, we have a pretty robust records management system. And our criminal division of information does our division of criminal information does an excellent job. These are the folks that you go down to get your concealed carry or pistol permit from and purchase it from. And Pat Freeman's over that section, and she works for both myself and Tammy Hooper, the city police chief. So they've got the ability to go in many times when a disqualifying crime has taken place, and we see that that permit, they're no longer eligible for that permit. And what the law obligates us to do is send them a letter notifying them that they can't buy or purchase. Now here's where the problem comes in. We don't go out and collect those permits. Yeah. Because that person may have moved, that person. So it's going to be really important, and here's my issue with making sure that NICS is robust and does the job for us. At the point of sale, that's when that check needs to take place that runs that person's individual record. And really where the big gap was, that was the gap on our side as far as that permit being good for 5 years. Where the gap has always been on the NICS side is having all that mental health information for folks who shouldn't have access to a firearm. So you, with the executive order around that, you're starting to see that hopefully clear up and be a little bit more effective that way.
And Sheriff, and one thing I just wanted to, like, we've got a good sheriff, we also have some pretty responsible firearms dealers in North Carolina, mm-hmm. in Buncombe County.
Yeah.
And I know of two that if they get a purchase permit that's aged, They're going to run a check anyway. They won't let somebody who's walking in with 4 years and 11 months that they got their permit and just selling them a handgun, they will actually go back and run it separately to make sure. They don't have to, but again, I think we've got some good folks in Buncombe County who are trying to keep us all safe.
And I don't want to speak outside of Buncombe County, but in Buncombe County, we pay very close attention to those ex partes and those orders that say a person must surrender those weapons. And we go to great lengths to make sure that they do until they have their court hearing, until that 50B is either enacted for a year or whether they don't enact it. We take those things extremely serious because, in all honesty, and I guess the best way to answer is we feel like we're responsible. If that's not covered and that person still has access to a gun that we knew that they had, that the order demands that they turn that over to the sheriff's office and we haven't received it, we feel like we're on the hook for that. So that's extremely important to us.
Yeah, and I'd just like to add, you can hear about what he has said and what others have said, how complex and difficult it is to actually create laws that manage this problem. I think we would all agree that anger and violent tendencies is a marker for someone that maybe shouldn't be able to buy weapons.
One concern I have is there about loopholes or at least lack of penalty. Is this idea that if there is a gun in the home and a toddler picks it up and they shoot the gun and somebody is killed, it's a misdemeanor?
Yeah, we know that story.
And that's a really
tragedy.
Really tragic. And so again, I think we're going back to the subject of public health. What is in the best interests of the health and safety of our citizens, instead of how many guns are out there and who's getting them?
Well, and to that point, Susan, so I've been working very closely with the sheriff's office because of some wrinkles in the legislation that was passed around notarization of forms and things like that, so that maybe when we get down the short session, we can kind of work some of these issues out. But I sat down with Ronnie Hilliard's with the Sheriff's Office Bureau of ID, as well as our clerk of court, Steve Cogburn, to kind of talk through some of these issues. And I learned a really interesting fact through this, which is if somebody is admitted to Mission's emergency department and they are mentally unstable and need to be involuntarily committed, they've got to go to court to be committed. Well, in order for that commitment to take place, the doctor has to come and testify to that effect. So there's a box on that form, Ronnie, you correct me if I'm wrong, that the doctors can check that says, I don't want to be notified of the court date. So that person goes to their court date, the doctor doesn't show up, there's no reason to adjudicate them and involuntarily commit them. They go back out on the street, that information is never collected, and so they're now eligible. They would pass a NICS background check. So there are some systemic public health issues that happen way before we ever get to the firearms purchase phase that need to be addressed in terms of how we're dealing with mentally ill folks in our community, what the role and responsibility of the doctors are, of the courts, to help solve some of these problems as well. So it's a much larger issue, public health issue, not necessarily directly related to just the permitting and background check process.
Well, I'd like to open up the session to questions. I'm sure that some of you will have some issues. Yes?
I have a couple of short questions. One is, I'm guessing that anybody with a concealed carry permit, that permit is not public knowledge. I can't go online someplace and find out who's got a concealed carry permit.
That's correct.
Okay. Second question, I remember hearing when the discussion about the legislation was going on, that it was going to be illegal for doctors to ask patients if they were concerned about the patient's mental status at that point, that it was going to be illegal for them to ask if there were a gun in the house. Is that true?
There was in one of the original drafts of the bill, it basically said that doctors and other medical professionals couldn't put it on a written questionnaire. So, you know, sometimes you go to the doctor and you fill it out, you know, do you smoke, do you drink, do you exercise? But doctors can still ask.
Oh, okay, that's important.
Yeah, and so, we got a lot of letters on that one.
And if memory serves me correctly, the portion about restricting the written questionnaires was actually struck from it.
Yeah.
I didn't hear the last
one. The portion regarding the written questionnaire was struck from the final version of the bill.
Oh, okay.
So the final version of this bill was, I mean, I think we went through 8 or 10 different drafts. And the final version is vastly different than the first version, which had a lot of really contentious pieces to it.
Yeah. Thank you.
More questions? Bob.
Brian, the comic book version of why did you vote for the gun law?
Sure. Well, for one, it included an amendment that I thought was important and that I'd worked really hard to get in place in the bill. So I wanted to show there had been support of my amendment, wanted to show support of the bill. I think that there are also some other aspects of the bill that talk about protections for gun ranges. And so that's some interesting things in there, as well as, and again, I go back to our great sheriff. We've got a great sheriff. There are some other sheriffs around the state that will refuse to sign off on paperwork for people to purchase certain kinds of weapons, even though they are eligible to at the state and federal level. And so, you know, that can be seen as somewhat of an overreach in terms of the authority. And so this bill also corrected some of those types of things. And, you know, I don't want to name names in the sheriffs, but there are a few in the state that say, I don't care if the ATF says that you are A-okay to purchase this weapon, I'm not going to approve it. And that really is kind of really kind of conflicts with what I think that role should be. So that was another aspect of it.
Just as a matter of history, the sheriff signing off on gun purchases in you know 60, 70 years ago was kind of a racial issue, and the Republicans brought that up, that they were trying to keep only the white folks in town having guns and not allow black folks. So there is that bad history as well. Is that accurate?
Yes, historically.
And it may still be some of that in some of these counties.
And it really caused some contentious debate on the floor during that portion.
Yes, sir. Sheriff Duncan.
Yes, sir.
In answering a question from Representative Fisher, I thought I caught some skepticism in your voice about technical procedures to keep other people from firing your gun. Could you enlarge on that a little bit?
I don't think technology is in such a place to where you can put particular locks on weapons that would require a PIN number, require a fingerprint, require those type things. And even if they were, it would boost the price of a firearm to where very few people would be able to afford to access it. And once again, you know, I always try to keep the conversation in what's kind of reasonable for most folks. And of course that definition changes. But there is some argument about that one of the ways that gun control will be pushed to an access is to make the cost of either the weapon or the ammunition so high that the common person can't afford to own or defend themselves with a firearm. And there's also a lot of things dealing from a law enforcement background that there you run into a lot of issues around access. If you're doing something, I mean, how's that going to be powered? Is it going to be a battery? Is it going to be, generally when you put something on a gun that makes it operate, you've got to come up with some sort of source to power that particular security device. And those things are extremely problematic. So that's where my skepticism comes from.
Yeah.
I appreciate the dialogue that we're having here, or you all were able to provide us. But a big issue for cities, especially those with housing authorities, are illegal guns. And you're not touching on illegal guns, guns that never hit the open market that are exchanged. And that's a concern for housing authorities, in the fact that the Justice Department used to have the Weed and Seed program that did buybacks and exchanges and provided good programs to negate the number of guns that were available on the street illegally. And so can you speak to the illegal market and the problems that we're having with crimes as it relates to illegal guns?
And that's why I brought up the whole pen idea, because, I mean, I think, you know, it's that whole thing, if we can put a man, woman on the moon, why in the heck can't we make guns have a stronger identification technology? And because we have, estimates are that we have about 300,000 guns floating around illegally, stolen guns. And that's, you know, that's kind of a drop in the bucket to the 300 million that we have around the U.S., which makes us way different from many, many other countries in terms of possessing of guns, either legally or illegally. But there ought to be something. And again, I go back to the whole public health thing. If there is a way that we could make it impossible for those stolen guns to be used, I mean, they're going to be out there. We can't expect law enforcement to, you know, do sweeps and gather up every single illegal gun that's out there, but there ought to be a way to keep them from being able to be unlocked if they are stolen. 300,000 is a lot.
Yeah, and the, you know, the NRA would say that's, of course, you know, you can't legislate guns, though the bad guys will get the guns. I'd be interested to know if you have an idea of how to deal with that. I think it's a great question.
I appreciate that opportunity. Some successes that I have had in the past. The gun buybacks got old guns and guns out of places that didn't need to be had. Really helped, and I think it was a great collaboration between the Sheriff Department and the Police Department. The education program, so that when kids did encounter an illegal gun in their home, they knew not to touch it, they knew why, they knew the problems associated with it. I would say that having information out in public settings where the audience is different, and providing information about what happens when you have an unregistered gun in your home and what possibilities could happen for adults, and it doesn't happen. I think the educational programs that exist pit people against each other as opposed to focusing on what happens when you have an illegal gun. Unfortunately, as an employee of the Asheville Housing Authority, we have had people who come in and sell things or try to sell things, and so it's important to educate people at different levels, and I think that's missing. There are no public servants announcements about illegal guns and what they can do to communities. I mean, I'm glad we're not in Chicago, no offense to Chicago, but for African American males, it's a horrible place in lower income neighborhoods to be, because you could be shot just because.
And I think, I think media and, you know, social media, television, newspaper, radio, all of that can play a big part in educating the public about.
And the focus would be illegal guns, so that we won't create this pitting people against the Second Amendment versus other people. It's illegal guns that I'm really focused on, not the registered guns, and you all, I'll let you all fight that. But I want to talk about the guns that don't get talked about.
Can I just do a little clarification?
Sure.
And the mayor's correct. There has been some successful programs, and gun buybacks are a little problematic in that sometimes the what we were buying back was not what would be used. I mean, you might have a black powder pistol and you were paid the price that would probably never be used in a crime, more than likely. So there were some loose constraints around gun buybacks. Just want to clarify about registry of guns. There is no requirement to register your firearm. So when we talk about illegal guns, you're talking about guns that have been stolen or guns that by the act the person has committed that they are not allowed to possess. So that's when we get into the illegal guns, that's what we're talking about, or a weapon that's had the serial number, attempt to remove the serial number. That would fall into the category of illegal by possession, illegal because it's stolen, or illegal because it's been altered in some way. So that would be those categories.
Well, I see another way for the state to raise some money. If we can make sure that guns are registered like a car would be, and get, you know, you have to have a license to drive a car.
I'll be honest with you. Once again, I love Susan. We do disagree amongst ourselves. That's okay. But generally, registration of guns is a conversation that drives the reasonable folks in the room kind of off the map. So
I don't know, it's state revenue. I see state revenue.
Sheriff, one question I have on this issue, besides the illegal guns that we've already discussed, there's another category of illegal guns, which are firearms that are not allowed in this country, heavy assault automatic weapons, or guns that have been altered so that they are illegally automatic. Do we see a big problem with that? I know it is in some of our larger cities in the country. Is that a problem in North Carolina significantly?
No, not that we see routinely. We see something the nature of a semi-automatic rifle that is a some folks call modern sporting rifles. Some folks refer to them as assault rifles. But if they are in the semi-automatic, which means one pull of the trigger fires one round, that would be a legal weapon. We don't see them used as far as the long guns, the rifle variants. We don't see them used in that many crimes day to day. You do see them used in high profile mass shootings a lot of times. As far as issues that we see here locally in Buncombe County, we have seen just a handful of people who try to alter a semi-automatic weapon to make it fire fully automatic, which means you pull the trigger, hold it down, and it keeps firing till the magazine or whatever loading mechanism it has is empty. We see that occasionally, very, very rarely. Most of the issues we deal with are folks who, quite frankly, a lot of the guns that we recover are stolen from other places. And which brings up another matter, and boy, I'm really going to kind of kick the bucket over. Right now, there's really no mechanism for a federal firearms dealer to call and find out if they have a stolen gun. There is no mechanism to make that happen.
That's amazing.
So there's still a lot of conversation around things that most everybody in the room would say, you know, that's really a good idea. Mm-hmm. We could get that done. And those are the things that I really like to see groups like this, when we come together, focus on.
And to that point, Sheriff, there's also no requirement that if you have a gun stolen, that you have to report it.
Correct.
So if my car or house gets broken into and my handgun and my shotgun is stolen, I don't have a requirement. Now, a federal firearms dealer does have a requirement that they have to report any discrepancies in their inventory within 48 hours. But there doesn't exist anything like that on the private side.
Certainly a good idea to do if your gun ends up being used in a crime and somebody comes knocking at your door to
accuse you of it.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, well, that idea that if, you know, I like to consider myself a responsible gun owner, and that if any of my firearms were ever to go missing, I would call the sheriff and I'd call the chief of police and let them know. But, you know, that kind of data would need to be able to support a stolen gun type of database, so that you know that my gun's been stolen.
Right.
Otherwise, you've got no idea. I know there have been some other pieces of legislation that have tried to work to make that a requirement, but it's working to make sure that people aren't fearful of making those reports, that they get concerned that if something gets stolen, if they don't realize it for a week or two, are they going to get in trouble, and things like that. So it's about balancing that so people feel comfortable making those reports.
Yes.
I'd like to return to the issue of education. I wondered if there's any way that what we've talked about here in terms of understanding the nature of stolen guns, how children can accidentally handle guns, can be done in our public schools so that kids start understanding at a young age that there's a danger involved in this. I mean, I don't want to be Pollyanna-ish, but it seems to me that some of this is valuable knowledge for young people to start knowing about when they're at the age when they're starting to see guns when they're 5-6 years old.
And I would say that a lot of that education comes back to the parent. I know that my daughter Eleanor, she's 8. She goes hunting with me sometimes. Since the day she was born, I have always told her that I don't care if it's a rubber band gun, I don't care if it's a Nerf gun or whatever, you don't point it at people. And that we don't play games in our house where people shoot other people. We don't play games in our house where you pick up guns.
But if people are leaving loaded weapons on tables for children, they don't have enough sense to educate their children.
But that education comes to the parent as well, of being a responsible gun owner. not leaving loaded weapons out, not leaving any weapons out, loaded or unloaded.
My point is maybe the schools are going to have to take some of the responsibility because all parents are not obviously responsible enough to do that.
Up front here, what is the mood of the legislature with respect to closing the ex parte loopholes, and do you expect it to be addressed in this next short session?
I honestly don't believe unless you can make those pieces of legislation have to do with the budget, that they will take them up in the short session. I think the soonest you might see some of these is in the next long session in 2017.
Yes.
This might be Pollyanna-ish, but in the legislature, would there ever be a climate whereby North Carolina could become the state that is the strongest supporter of the Second Amendment, yet also the safest place to own a gun or to have guns? And that would mean getting together a focus group of some sort that would be educators and engineers and psychologists and medical doctors and anybody who could bring something to the table to make North Carolina the safest state in the country for guns, and again, still supporting the Second Amendment. Have you ever seen that possible?
It sounds like an election platform. Your timing might be just right.
That used to be the main focus of the NRA was
education. Yeah. Right.
In the back.
Yeah, in answer to that lady's question about education, the NRA does have a program.
Eddie the Eagle program.
The Eddie Eagle program, where they go into schools and teach kids gun safety.
Yeah.
I don't know what schools they go into, but they do have that program. So the NRA is trying to educate children that when they see a gun, you walk away from it. You don't touch it. And that's a very big part of the NRA. Also, the loophole thing. A lot of that is fabricated. There is no loophole. If you sell a gun at a gun show and you're a gun dealer, you have to go through the same NICS background checks for that sale as you do in your store.
Right. I think some people refer to, I think when people, you know, I think the term gun show loophole is a bit of a misnomer. I think what you know when people refer to that, what they're really talking about, what I was talking about with Roni, that if he and I are engaged in the private sale of a long gun, there's no background check requirement. And if I'm not a federally licensed firearms dealer and I go to the gun shows and I see guys walking around with their deer rifle with a little note taped to it saying, you know, $650 or best offer. You know, those are private individuals who are selling that gun privately with no background check. So I think that's where that terminology gun show loophole comes from. But if you're Phil Flack, if you're Don Malicote and you're a federally licensed firearms dealer, you're running those background checks.
And I also had a comment. After the Sandy Hook murders, President Obama issued an executive order for the CDC to do a study on gun violence. And their study came back and said that guns are used to stop crimes in America 500,000 to 3 million times a year. The study also said that mass shootings and accidental firearm deaths account for a small fraction of gun-related deaths, and both are declining. And it also said armed citizens are less likely to be injured by an attacker. So their study shows that a lot of guns in our society help save people's lives from 500,000 to 3 million times a year. That's murders, rapes, home invasions, whatever crime. It didn't go into definitions of what crimes were stopped.
Well, and I think we were talking about, you know, reasonable arguments for and against different things. You know, there is a value to being able to have a firearm to defend yourself, defend your house, to be able to go target shooting, things like that. I think the challenge becomes, especially with the CDC, is that Congress at several opportunities has blocked their ability to do and to fund research into gun violence or what have you. And so the data sets that they have to work off are very limited. If we're really going to look at this from a public health perspective, Let's give the CDC the funding and the ability to really investigate this stuff. But I'd be interested to see the study that you have, maybe after this.
That's exactly what I was going to follow up with, is that President Obama asked for a mere $10 million to be appropriated to the CDC for a study after the Sandy Hook shootings, and the House of Representatives refused the funding. So I'm not, and you know, to your point, I think that the more we are willing to give to this sort of public health angle, the more, I think, the more results we're going to see in terms of health and safety for our citizens.
Right. And like I said, I think that, you know,
executive order for that $10 million.
I think it's a great opportunity. You know, we study the heck out of everything, it seems like. You know, and we've got some great minds in this country, some great research universities. We've got a bunch of great research universities here in our state. You know, let's leverage those resources to make North Carolina safe, but also make sure that we're continuing to support our Second Amendment.
Well, let's not use fear.
Oh, absolutely.
That's right.
On either side.
I agree.
On either side.
In the purple.
I just wanted to address the public safety issue that Representative Fisher has mentioned, and it's been mentioned by a few other people. And I'm very, very grateful that we're having this conversation. I kind of see this process as one that is similar to making smokers aware of the danger every time they're buying a pack of cigarettes, making those who drink alcohol have a designated driver. Those were campaign seatbelts. Those were campaigns that finally reached a tipping point, that it changed a country's culture. And that is what I think about gun safety and gun education. And my question is, and I'm not sure, I did try to find out, but the internet just doesn't offer anything. I don't know if the tobacco companies were forced, or if they did it voluntarily. I don't know if the alcohol companies were forced or they did it voluntarily. So my question is, do you think that this process can continue without the NRA?
I'm unclear. With the process?
Of making a cultural change about how people view guns, getting ads on the television, having billboards, making that tipping point actually occur. Now, I think that there were funds, now certainly the tobacco companies do put funds into that, the alcohol companies do put funds into that, and I would love it if the NRA would also put more funds. I know they have education programs, but there's a lot more that they could do. And my question is, I don't see them being very, very willing to do so, so do you believe that we will be able to make progress without the support of the NRA?
Just to address one thing in your question, the tobacco companies were mandated to do some of that warning, and there are mandatory warnings on alcohol as well. There are some public
federal, like from the ATF.
Yes, there are some public relations moves that those organizations have also done, perhaps cynically, perhaps in the interest of public health, but there have been some moves on their own.
And when you do buy a firearm, when you go to a dealer and buy a firearm new in the box, what have you, you know, it does come with safety warnings. And it does come with sort of the 10 golden rules of firearms ownerships and safety, talking about, you know, make sure you know your target and what's behind it, treat every gun as if it were loaded. And so that does come when you do purchase a firearm. So some of that education safety piece from the industry is there. It's not as prevalent maybe as we've seen with tobacco and alcohol, but there are some things in there.
It's also mandated to come with a trigger lock of some sort.
Yep.
You also have to sign that you have received notification. I believe the statute's about if somebody gets the gun, if a minor has access to the gun, you have to sign that now, and you're provided a copy of that statute at the point of purchase. So there are things. Are there more? Absolutely. Boy, I'm going to wander off and make everybody mad before I leave here, and I hate to do that.
Sure's going to be like, well,
honestly,
I got to go.
Honestly, think, you know, that's what these conversations are for, and where I'm coming with this is I'm not a member of the NRA, and I'll give you an anecdotal story as to why. I had somebody call, and I do support most of what they do, but if you'll remember, after the Waco incident, I had somebody call and try to get me to become a member of the NRA, and they sold it as you don't want the federal jackbooted thugs coming in and doing you like they did David Koresh at Waco. I'm not going to tell you what I told him, but I hung up on him, and I've never been able to move myself to get there because of some of that way out talk. Now, here's the way out talk on the other end. When we start talking about things to where you're going to open up litigation on gun companies that have sold a firearm that was used in a crime. Those are, to me, on both sides, those are conversation stoppers. And that's why I think a lot of times you've got to keep the conversation in the middle of things around safety. I do look forward to the CDC being able to do some good, validated, empirical studies around gun violence and the things that will make us safer. Nobody seemed to be too mad. Nobody threw anything. I appreciate that.
That's a good point. I know that that part of the executive order from the president asked for studies to happen, evidence-based studies by public health experts. And I think that if we, I think there's room at the table for everybody in that discussion. And it's certainly something that I think most of us, when we look at the numbers of guns that we have in the United States compared to other countries, I think it's something that we should all sort of welcome. If we just make it all about enforcing laws, I don't think that speaks to people nearly as well as what concerns your health and safety. It's not about round them up and throw them in jail. It's about what is going to be best in terms of preserving life.
Thank you. I know there are more questions, but unfortunately we're out of time. Thank
Frank,
everybody for coming.
Yeah. Frank, I'd just like to say something. And you know, Representative Fisher has made some really good points, but I also want to encourage everybody in this room to learn more. I love to hunt. I was down in Hyde County earlier this year duck hunting in a county that basically is the second lowest in population, second largest in land mass. And so, when you talk to folks down there about hunting traditions, about gun ownership, take a moment to educate yourself about not necessarily just folks who are in the city of Asheville or even in Buncombe County, which is still really not that rural, but, what's going on in the rest of our state? What's going on in the rest of our country? I encourage if anybody here who has never gone to shoot a gun, go down to On Target. They'll let you rent one and walk in the range, and they'll show you how, and Jeff will show you how to pull the trigger and not hurt yourself or anybody else. Take those opportunities to educate yourself, get some hands-on experience, understand what it's like. And people who are strong Second Amendment advocates, also take time to educate yourself about the public health implications. So I think the more we educate each other, the better dialogues we can have and the fewer polarizations there will be. And so, and I'm more than happy to take anybody in this room out squirrel hunting or target shooting.
Well, there are lots of questions that we can still be talking about, answering, and discussing. I hope you'll take an opportunity to talk with each of these folks if they'll stay for a few more extra minutes and ask them questions personally. Again, I want to really thank all of you for coming to this forum. We could sit, I think we could have a whole day or maybe a week talking about this. But I really appreciate the diversity of opinions and viewpoints and the civil dialogue and civic dialogue that we find so rare, but that is so important. And to kind of echo what Brian is saying, education is a key. Please keep us in mind when you are trying to inform yourselves. Go to carolinapublicpress.org. We do cover the 18 counties of Western North Carolina. So while we all love Buncombe County, we love Asheville, there's a lot of other people in our region, and we do cover those folks as well. If you look at some of our reporting about gun issues, we do look at them county by county and statewide. We have a reporter in Raleigh covering the state legislature as well. So please keep us in mind when you're searching for information. And if you'd like to support our news organization, we are a nonprofit. We're a little bit different from our for-profit friends. So please keep this in mind as well. We are having 9 more of these types of conversations this year. We're really excited about this. We're going to be covering some of the top public interest issues facing our region. In February, we're having one on wilderness. Some of you may know there's a lot of debate about the addition of wilderness areas in Western North Carolina, particularly in the Pisgah and Nantahala National Forest. So we're going to have a Newsmakers conversation with a stellar panel as well. And that'll be February 26th, and we'll be sure to let you all know that too. So again, thank you. Grab some stuff on your way out, and please feel free to talk to any of us personally. Thanks again.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Good job.